That is okay. So we did that. Now today we'll start our Python journey. Okay, so let's start. What is Python and everything? Before that, let me come to the properties of the Python. What is Python and how it is different from the other languages? Right? Am I audible? Once again, I'm confirming.
Yes.
Okay. Fine. Yes, so, beta, we are going to design our data science journey with the help of Python. Right? There are several reasons why Python is becoming so much popular. So first of all, let us understand few features, few very important features of the Python. First of all, Python is a high level language. I will assume that you have zero knowledge of Python. Remember, okay? I will assume that even if you have a knowledge, for those people who doesn't have any Python knowledge, I will assume that you don't have any knowledge of Python, means you are just a beginner in the Python programming language. From that point, I'll put it up. Okay, so it's a high level language. I think everyone is clear what is high level language. Why high level language? We humans ourselves consider ourselves as a top breed. Means we are superior. We are better than lion. We are better than tigers. We are better than snakes, dogs, and everything. We consider ourselves as a top priority. So whatever comfortable to us, we say, we are high level, so everything is high level, which is comfortable to us. Okay, so what is the high level language? That language which is comfortable to us, we're able to understand that properly. Is it fine? The language which we are able to understand means the language which is written in terms of very much like English statements, like print, output, something like that, which we humans can easily understand. We consider that language as a high level language. Okay, but the problem is that the machines doesn't understand high level language. They understand only ones and zeros. And we normally call them as low level language. Our computer, our mobile phone, they doesn't understand high level language. They only understand low level language. Okay, I repeat once again, Python is a high level language, means that language which is understandable to the human. And machines understand low level language. First thing is clear, Python is a high level language. So we will be having statements very much like our English language. Second thing, understand. It combines the mixture of C and Java. I repeat once again, Python combines the properties of C and Java. Your C is basically a procedure based language. Okay, and Java is basically your object oriented language. Okay, so it takes the benefit of C programming language, it takes the benefit of Java programming language, combines both of them. Okay, it combines the properties of C language, that is procedure based language, and the Java, which is object oriented language. Okay, so there are two statements we have studied so far. Python is a high level language. Second, it combines the features of C language, which is a procedure based language. And second, Java, which is an object oriented language. We'll come to these terms, don't worry. For now, understand, procedure is nothing but a sequence of statements. Procedure is nothing but a sequence of statement. With the C programming, how do we write the program? You take the help of sequence of statements and the functions. Means in C language, we used to write the program using functions and procedures. And what is procedures? Procedures is nothing but a sequence of statements which execute sequentially. That's it. And what is a function? A set of statements which is used to perform a specific task. I repeat once again, what is a function? A set of statements which are used to perform a specific task is known as a function. Is it fine? What is a function? A function is nothing but a set of statements which are used to perform a specific task. And what is a procedure? Nothing but a sequence of statements which execute sequentially. Now come to what is object-oriented language. See, understand, what is there are different types of languages. One is a procedure-based language. Yes, we understand what is C. Now come to the Java. Java is object-oriented language. Before understanding what is object oriented, let us understand two terminologies, which is known as class, and second is known as object. Until we know these two technical terms, we will not be in the condition to understand. Buta, please mute yourself. Somebody, mic is unmuted and it is creating disturbance. Please, but it's a request. Please mute yourself. Okay. So two things we should be aware of. One thing is what is a class, and second thing, what is an object? Okay. Understand. Class is what? Class is nothing but a blueprint. I repeat once again. Class is what? Class is nothing but a blueprint on the basis of which you construct an object. I repeat again. Class is nothing but a blueprint on the basis of which you construct your object. Example, take a class, take an example. Suppose there is a God and God decided once, I will create humans. He decided, I will create humans, and he decided that humans should have certain properties and should be capable to perform certain functions. For example, he said that humans should have two eyes. Humans should have two hands. Humans should have two legs. These are the properties or attributes that humans should possess. And he said that humans should be capable of walking. Humans should be capable of talking. Okay. Humans should be capable of making friendships or something like that. Friends, right? So for the humans, we decided humans should be capable of performing certain functions, like walking, talking, and friends, and he should have some properties or attributes. He decided, first of all, this, right? So he decided to create humans. And for the humans, he decided that every human needs to satisfy these properties and needs to satisfy these functions, right? So this human's blueprint, which he created, but somebody, mics is unmuted. I have to mute them manually, please. It's a request. Other people are getting disturbed. So please unmute. Don't unmute yourself. Okay. So he decided a human should have this blueprint. Means he should have two eyes, two hands, and two legs. He should have these functions, walking, talking, friends, and much more. So this is a blueprint which has been created to make humans. So this is known as human class. Okay. From this blueprint, now humans are created. Like what? I am created. Who is created? Praveer Saxena is created. Understand. And Praveer Saxena satisfy all these properties and all these functions. Human doesn't physically exist. Class doesn't physically exist. But Praveer Saxena physically exists. If I ask you, please, can you tell me there is a human? Who is human? Human is a class. Human is a class. There is no one physically you can point out. This is a human. We belongs to human class. We belongs to human class, and we physically exist. The thing which physically exists but is derived from the class, from the human class, is known as object. So Praveer Saxena is what? Who physically actually exists is known as object. And being an object, I will satisfy all the proper, I will possess all the properties of the human class and all the functions of the human class. I repeat once again, there are two terminologies. One is class, one is object. Class is what? Class is something which is a blueprint. Class is something which is a blueprint of making something. And class doesn't physically exist. From that class, or from this blueprint, we create objects. So myself has been created, Praveer Saxena has been created. And being an object of the human class, I have all the properties what human should have. I should have two eyes, I should have two hands, I should have two legs. I should be able to perform walking, talking, and making friends. Similarly, there's another class known as, example, dog class. There's a class known as dog. So suppose someone has a doggy, his name is Tommy. Some has another doggy known as, example, Bruno. So can anybody tell me among these three terminologies, dog, Tommy, and Bruno, who is a class and who is object?
Dog is a class.
Dog is a class.
Very good, beta. Very 100%. Yes. Dog is a class and Tommy physically exists, right? Bruno physically exists. So these are what? These are objects. I think it is clear. Everyone. Okay. So things are clear. And in Python, everything is object. We'll see that. Everything an object of some class. In Python, everything is an object of some class. You will see that. I hope things are clear, right? That's why the name is object-oriented language. Means in this language, everything is an object. There are certain benefits of that. There are certain benefits of creating object-oriented language. You will understand that. Once we create a class, that's very easy. Suppose I create a class of a human. Two eyes, two hands, two legs. Walking, talking, friends. What I have to do? I have to just, everything is ready. Blueprint is ready. From that blueprint, create an object. For example, the currency printing, like our Indian rupees getting printed. For printing that currency, first we create a blueprint. And from that blueprint, we actually print the currency notes. The blueprint in that currency is a class. And when we are getting actual currency in our hand, that is an object. So things become very easy once you have a blueprint. Our lives become very easy. You don't have to write code again and again and again and again because you have the blueprint with you. Create another thing from. Directly create instance of that blueprint. Object, sometimes also known as instance of the class. Remember that. This is a technical terminology. Object is sometimes also known as instance of the class. An object physically exists. Class doesn't physically exist. I hope it is clear to everyone. Please tell me any doubt in this concept. What is a class? What is an object? But you're free to ask if you have any doubt. And I'm assuming that you have zero programming knowledge. Don't worry about that. Anyone, any doubt, please. I'm waiting. If you don't have any doubt, just say I'll move ahead.
No, sir.
Great. Great. Let's move ahead. So two things we have studied so far. Python is a high level language. Second, Python is derived from C and Java, which means it combines a feature from C and Java, both the procedure based languages as well as object oriented languages. Every language has certain benefits. So it combines both of them. Third, very important property. Okay, third one. It is dynamically typed language. Typed language. Understand what does it mean. If it is a dynamically typed language, suppose you have studied C. Suppose I am taking an example. If you study C, in C, how we declare variables? We declare variables like this. Suppose I have a variable A, and I want to assign a value known as 3, which is an integer, right? So in C programming, I will write like this: int A equal to 3. Is it fine? I will like int A equals to 3. So once I declare this statement, and if I try to assign A equals to 4.5, I try to assign A equals to 4.5, it will show syntax error. It will show me an error because what will happen? Earlier, you have said that A is of the type integer. And here you are assigning them floating point number. Are you getting my point? Right? Here you are assigning floating point number, but earlier you have defined it to be integer type. So you can't assign that because earlier you have declared that A should be of integer type. When we explicitly declare any integer, means A will always remain integer, it is known as statically typed. Statically typed. It is statics. It will remain integer only. But the advantage of what Python is that we don't need to declare this thing. First thing, I will mention A equals to 3. The moment I put A equals to 3 in Python, I'm talking about Python. This was I was talking about C programming. Now I'm talking about the Python programming. So The moment I declare A equals to 3, what will happen? Automatically, my Python interpreter will understand that this A needs to be integer right now. So it will, if I check what is the class of A, so I will type of A, it will throw me that it's an integer. I'll show you that. Just a second, in fraction of seconds, let me open it, my Jupyter notebook, so that you can practically see that. Okay, so I'm doing A equals to 3. That's it. I'm taking a variable A and assigning it a value 3. How the variable works, I'll come to that only in few seconds. Don't worry. Okay, so I'm running it for now. Once I run this, let me check the type of A. Sorry. Yeah, I'm typing. Type is a function, inbuilt function in the Python, which tells you about the which class it belongs to. Okay, so I am putting type of A. Tell me what class the A belongs to. So I'm checking it. See, it is telling me automatically that it is of the type integer. Is it fine? Automatically, you don't declare that. In the next statement, again, on the same variable, I'm assigning 4.5. It won't throw an error. Dynamically, it will change the data type of A. Automatically, it will change the type of A depending upon the execution of the program. I'm running it. It is not throwing me an error. And now if I check the type of A, it will throw me a float. Can you check it? Right? So dynamically, the data type of a variable can be changed in Python, which is not in C. That's why it is known as dynamically typed language. I hope it is clear. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Everyone, please. Is it okay?
Yes. Yes, yes.
Great. Great. Okay. You get the understanding what is statically typed and what is dynamically typed. Okay. Fourth point. Let's come to fourth point now. The fourth point is, the fourth point is Python is a interpreted language. Interpreted language. What do you mean by that? Python is an interpreted language, and sometimes it is also in a scripting language. Scripting language doesn't use compiler. I'll come to that. What is interpreter? I'll come to that. Understood. I earlier told you that Python is a high level language. It's a high level language. Right? But our machines, if you talk about our machine, this is our machine, it only understands a language which is known as machine language. Like a processor. My processor is Core i5. So understand only machine language, that is 1 and 0. It is a high level language, like we mentioned, type. See, it's an English-like language. If I type print, it's an English-like language. So we need to translate this high level language into a low level language. We need to translate this high level language to a low level language. For the same, we require translators. To translate a high level language into a low level language, we need a translator. But if you have seen the meetings of United Nations, there the people from everywhere come across. For example, a person come from Germany. He doesn't understand English. So he speaks in his German language. But every other representative from different countries used to wear a headphone. And that headphone as an inbuilt translator, which translates German language to the English language automatically. Otherwise, somebody speaking German and I don't know German, then a speak is useless for me. If I have a translator in my headphone and somebody is speaking in German, and if my translator is able to translate the German language into my English language, my life is easier. Same way, you understand high level language, machine understand low level language. If you want to machine understand my high level language, we need to translate it. we need to convert it. For that, we require translators. Okay, so there are normally two kinds of translators. If we leave assembly language as apart, if we leave assembly language apart, there are normally two kinds of translators. One known as compiler. It is a translator. Second, known as interpreter. Second type of translator. Both are translators. Okay, both does what? They takes high level language and converts them into a low level language. Same with the interpreter as well. Takes up high level language, converts them into a low level language. Then what is the difference between them? Understand how compiler works and understand how interpreter works. That is the main issue. Okay? Suppose I write a program in C. Let's say I write a program in the C. This is statement one, statement two, statement three, statement four, statement five. So if my language is compiler based, then what it will do, it will take the entire set of statements. Okay. It will take entire set of statements, check their syntax. If the syntax are correct, check the syntax. If the syntax are correct, then convert the entire set of statements, this entire program, into a low level language. Okay, I'm repeating again. It will take entire set of statements or entire program, check their syntax. If there is no syntactical error, then converts the entire program into a low level language. Means entire program is going to be converted. Entire program or whatever set of statements we are compiling is going to be converted into a low level language with the help of compiler. Is it fine? And the output normally compiler gives is known as object code, which can be executed. The output it gives is known as object code. But in case of interpreter, suppose you have same set of statements S1, S2, S3, S4, and S5. What interpreter does, it doesn't consider entire program at one go. It takes one statement at a time. It takes one statement at a time, check its syntax. If it is fine, it converts it into the low level language and executes it. Fine. What it does, again, once S1 is completely executed, go to the S2. If S2 syntax is fine, take second statement, convert it into the low level language and execute it. Please mute yourself. Somebody is unmuted. Okay, it will execute it. Again, it will go to the S3. If S3 also doesn't have any syntactical error, it will convert it into the low level language and execute. In case S4 is having some error, it will stop here only. It won't convert S4 into low level language, neither it will go to the S5. Now hope things are clear. Okay. And in this case, even if single statement in the compiler case, even if single statement is having some error, you won't get low level language of anything. Because it considers all the statement at a time or all the program at a time. So check the syntax of all the statement which are written. If every statement is fine, only then it is going to translate. Here, what happens? You check statement one, then statement two, check statement one, convert into low level program, execute it. Check statement two, convert into low level program, execute two means it treats each statement as independent statement. I hope the things are clear about compiler and interpreter. Please tell me. Is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Everyone? Yes, sir. Everyone?
Yes, sir.
That's great. Means compiler is clear, interpreter is clear. Okay. Now understand one very, very important thing, how the Python program is actually executed. How the Python program is actually executed. Suppose I write up a program of Python. Right? It is having a set of statements S1, S2, S3, S4 or something like that. So first of all, a Python compiler will be called. Understand what I am writing. Please, please understand. You will be getting confused. Python is an interpreted language. And remember that thing. It's an interpreted language. So it is going to this thing. But what I am writing right now, understand. Python used a software known as Python compiler. What it does, this normal Python compiler is written in C language. It takes your high level language and converts this high level language into an intermediate language, not low level language, into an intermediate, that is midway. And that intermediate language is known as bytecode. This Python compiler will take your high level language and convert your high level language into an intermediate language known as bytecode. Now, to convert that bytecode into your low level language, you require one more piece of software, which is known as Python Virtual Machine. Python Virtual Machine, in short known as PVM, and it has an interpreter. Okay, and this Python Virtual Machine does have an interpreter. Now it converts my bytecode into a low level language. This is how your program gets executed. First, with the help of Python compiler, my high level language is converted into an intermediate language known as bytecode. Why bytecode? Because here every statement is of 1 byte. 1 byte means 8 bits. 1 byte basically means 8 binary digits. So here every statement is of 1 byte. That's why it is known as bytecode. And where this bytecode is important, understand there are two very, very important things. But now today's era of modular programming. Modular programming means, suppose there is a big, big project. Suppose of Amazon. Amazon is working on a big project. Okay, so one person cannot complete one complete project. So they require a team. So what they do, they divide the entire task into small subtasks. Task T1, task T2, task T3, task T4, and something like that. Okay, they divide the task into T1, T2, T3, T4. Right? I work on task T1. You work on task T2, somebody works on the task T3. Okay. We successfully completed our program. I completed my program successfully. You completed your program successfully. Somebody else completed your program successfully. One way is to that, share that Python file incomplete. Means without execution, I just give the Python file to you. Okay. Or our team manager. I gave, you gave, everyone gave. So what will happen? Let me show here. That is better if I show that way. Suppose there is an entire project, which is this complete project. We divide it into the sub projects, and that sub project is given to me. One module is given to me, means Praveer Saxena. Second project is given to, let's say, Rama. Subtask. One subtask is given to me. One subtask is given to Rama. One subtask is given to, let's say, Tanu ma'am. And one subtask is, let's given to Harsh, example. Okay. I successfully completed my Python program. Rama successfully completed. Tanu ma'am successfully completed. Harsh successfully completed. Okay. So suppose in the end, we want integration of everything, combine everything. But before that, I want to check what Praveer has done, what Rama has done, what Tanu has done, what Harsh has done. So one way to share is, share the Python file. Okay. So suppose Rama gave me one Python file, but the problem with the Python file is that if I want to check it, okay. If I want to check it, then first of all, what I have to do, I have to compile it using Python compiler. Right. After Python compiler, I'll get a bytecode. From that bytecode, I will use what? PVM, Python Virtual Machine. That will convert into the low-level language. Now my processor will execute. So it takes time, right? So can we skip this step? Can we skip this step? Yes, we can. Instead of sharing Python file, better we share a bytecode, which has already been compiled. So it saves our time. It saves our time. And once you share the bytecode, the things become very much easier for you. For example, I'm using my system on Linux. Okay, you are working a system on, let's say, Mac, and somebody else is working on bytecode. Sorry, not bytecode, but Linux, Mac and Windows, example. Okay. So what I have to do, I have to give my bytecode to them. I'll give my bytecode to each of them. My bytecode. Okay. Now, every system, this Linux, Mac, and Windows will have their own PVMs, Python Virtual Machines, in their system. Okay. So what will happen? These Python Virtual Machine actually interacts with your operating system, because operating system knows the truth of about your system. For example, if I show you my system here, and I right click here, properties, can you see my specifications are written here? Intel Core i5, 2.5 gigahertz, 16 GB of RAM, something like that. 64-bit operating system, 64-bit processor. How come this is displayed here? My operating system has actually interacted with my hardware, and it has come to know. These are the specifications. So what will happen? Operating system knows everything about my hardware. So what will happen? My PVM will interact with the operating system, and operating system will tell PVM, these are the hardware requirement. This is Core i5 processor. This is Core i3. This is dual core. Accordingly, PVM will convert depending upon your hardware specification or according to the corresponding machine language program, which can be run on your particular hardware specifications. So that this, if this is Core i3, it should run successfully. If it is Core i5, it should run successfully. If it is dual core, it should run successfully. This is the best part if you are using a bytecode. Is it fine? So same bytecode can run on any system, whether it is a Linux or a Mac or a Windows. PVM will help you out. Python Virtual Machine will help you out, because Python Virtual Machine interacts with your operating system, and operating system already interacts with the hardware, and operating system knows all the truth about your hardware. So it tells the PVM, you need to convert your bytecode into the machine language as per this processor requirement, so that your code can efficiently run there. I hope things are clear. Please tell me, everyone.
Yes, sir.
Get an idea how it runs. First of all, your high-level language code will be taken. That high-level language code will be converted into the bytecode with the help of Python compiler, right? Now, that bytecode will be converted into the low-level language using a software known as Python Virtual Machine. And all these are integrated inside your system. You won't see that. But I do have an option of saying, if somebody, suppose you want to share your PYC file, you can't see that. Let me show you one thing, one very, very important and critical thing. I'm opening here my Anaconda prompt. Okay, this is my Anaconda prompt. It is open. Let me check my Python version. So I'm typing Python minus minus version. So it showed me Python 3.8.8. Fine, perfect, fine. See. What I am doing, I'm opening a notepad here. Okay. And here I'm writing a simple Python program which says print hello. That's it, hello world. This is your first Python program. Means it will nothing do, it will do nothing. Just print hello world. That's it, nothing else. So what I will do, I will go to file, save as. I'm saving it on the desktop. Here, just mention it all files and give the name. Suppose I'm giving the name test dot py. Py is extension of Python files. Okay. Py is extension of Python files. So just mention test.py. I save it here. It has been saved on my desktop. You can see it is showing us test.py. I'm going back to my Anaconda prompt. Where this file is located? This file is located on my desktop. And currently it is showing that I am not at desktop. I'm at C users del. So let me move to the desktop. So how I will do? I will type a DOS command CD, mean change directory to desktop. And you move to the desktop. I just type CD desktop. They move there. Now see, it can be shown that I'm at the desktop. Fine. Here, what I am typing, I want to run this code using my Python. So what I will type py, I'm not using here notebook. This is just simple how your Python program works. That is very much required for you to understand how the Python code actually works. Okay. So I'm typing Python, right? First one, Python. This tells you that you are calling your Python compiler and interpreter. The moment you write Python, it understands you need to call Python compiler and interpreter Python. And then your file name. What is my file name? File name is test.py. As simple as that. I just type Python test.py and press enter. I should see hello world written just below it. Can you see that? Please tell me, can you see that?
Yes, sir. Yes,
right? Sir. But can you see on my desktop? Can you see any PYC file here? Can you see any PYC file, any folder, something like this? No, it's not visible. It's all happening behind the hood. But suppose you want to see that PYC file. You do have an option. How will you see? See, type Python again to tell that you are going to call your Python compiler and interpreter. Now, to see your PYC file or to create a PYC file, you need to call a module. You need to call a module. And in Python, to call a module, we type minus M. I give the space and type minus M, which indicates that I am about to call a module. And that module is known as py underscore compile. That module is known as py underscore compile. Means this is telling, first of all, first instruction is telling I need to call my compiler or interpreter. Minus M is telling I need to call a module. Which module I'm going to call? I'm going to call py underscore compile. Once it is written, just type your Python file name. What is the Python file name? Python file name is test.py, and you'll see the beauty. Your PYC file will be available on the desktop the moment I run it. Let's see. Can you see that? I've just received PY cache. Let's check it. Open it. Can you see file? Please check it. Can you people see? My PYC file is available. Now this file can be shared with anyone you want. It all happens behind the hood. But if you are planning to become a good Python engineer in the future, then these things you should know, which very few people know. But if you have practiced, then you people will know for sure. If you have worked on the live skill project, then you have the idea. If you're just a normally programmer, normal do normal programming, not work on the large projects, then these things normally are skipped. But don't worry. I hope everybody got an idea. Right? Is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Right. Now, one very, very important thing once more. Suppose I want to see what bytecode it is. I got a PYC file. Now, I want to see what is the bytecode. Okay. I want to see what is my bytecode, which has been converted by a Python compiler. So what I have to do? The PYC, come, you understand what is PYC means? Python compiler. That's why it is known as Python compiled file. It is known as Python compiled file. That's why PYC. It all happens behind the hood. Normally, don't see this. Okay. Earlier, I run the program. Did you see that? No. But when I call a module to get it, then only I get it. Okay. So again, I want to see the bytecode. So same. One more thing. When you are working on the DOS prompt or command prompt, I don't want to write the complete code again. I will just press up arrow. See, the entire code comes here. Okay. Entire code comes here. I just press the up arrow and the entire code comes here. So instead of that, calling py compile module here, I'm calling another module. I'm calling another module, and that particular module is known as this module, any display module. Okay, this module, and it will show me your bytecode here. Just enter it. I think you should get it. Can you see that? This is your bytecode, which is available over here. Is it fine? Please tell me.
Sir, can you tell us again what information we are getting?
See, if we are using this information, suppose I am typing Python, okay, minus m, this, and I'm running my file test.py, then what it is doing, it is giving me the bytecode, which is being generated by the Python compiler. Is it fine? So this will display you the Python compiled code that is known as your bytecode. Okay. So if I'm running it, I'll get it. This is your bytecode, which is written here. Is it fine?
Yes, yes, definitely. Okay. Good.
I hope you understand this thing. Please tell me. Is it okay with everyone? Please.
Yes, sir.
Everyone.
Yes, sir. Okay.
That's great. One more thing I'd like to tell you. Suppose this is Anaconda prompt I've opened. Let me press exit. So I've closed it. If I go to my normal command prompt, okay, normal. This was the Anaconda prompt. Understand the thing, please. I went through this Anaconda prompt. And here I'm typing the Python version. It is telling me -- version. It is telling me the version. See? So I'm exiting from this. And suppose I'm going here and typing command prompt, CMD. Windows normal command prompt. It's not an Anaconda prompt. Okay. I'm same place C user cell. Now try to run same command. Python -- first. What will happen? It will show that Python is unrecognized command. But you have installed the Python, but still it is showing on CC. You will see that. See what is this mentioning? Python was not found. Can you see that? Right? It is showing that Python was not found. Same way, if I want to check the Anaconda version, then I have to type conda -- version. Again, it will show same. Conda is not recognized as the internal external command. In case, although you can run all the programs from Anaconda prompt, but in interview, it may be asked, you have installed only Anaconda Navigator. You have installed only Anaconda Navigator, and I don't want to run my program from Anaconda prompt. I want to run my program from command prompt. How will you do that? The problem is that although you have installed the Anaconda Navigator, Python as well, but you have not added the path to the Windows. That is the main problem. Okay, let me show you that. Type here. Environment variables. The moment you type ENVI, it will show that added system environment variables. Added system environment variables. I click on the same. Okay. Then I bottom, I click on environment variables. And after environment variables, I click on the path. Okay. Once I click on path, click on edit. And see, it has not been added. Neither Python nor Anaconda. It has by default is not been added here. If you want to run your program from command prompt, you have to add it here. And how you can do that? I'll tell you that. So let's come to that point also. How can we do that? So I'm closing my command prompt. Yeah. I'm opening my Anaconda Navigator, Anaconda prompt. Yeah. Okay. So let me check where actually the Python exe file is and where actually the conda exe file is. I have to know, right? Although manually you can go to the C user's shell and search it. You can search it. Okay. But better way is to ask the command prompt. Your Anaconda prompt. It will tell you immediately. Why? Just type where and type Python. Where Python. Enter. Immediately tell me that it is at C user's shell Anaconda This is the path. I have to add this part with my environment variables. This part above mentioned. Similarly, I want to know where my anaconda is. So I'll type where conda. I'll type where conda. It will tell me its path. exe file. See, it's the exe file. So what I have to do, first of all, copy this. Don't copy slash and Python exe. Just use anaconda exe, anaconda 3. Copy it from here. Just a second, control C. Okay. And again, go to the environment, edit system environment variables. Environment variables, path, edit, new, and paste it. Is it fine? Again, click on new. Go there, back to your command prompt, sorry, conda prompt, and copy beside this slash, before this slash, copy everything from C to scripts. Control C, edit, and I click here, I guess, new, yeah, and paste it. That's it. Click on OK. Click on OK. Okay. Click on OK. And exit from here, from command, from Anaconda prompt. Now open your command prompt, CMD. So we saw earlier, it was not recognizing what is Python, what is conda, right? So I'm typing now Python minus minus version, keeping our finger crossed and pressing enter. Again, it's not showing. Python was not found. Let's wait a second. I think some mistake must have happened. Let me check again. Conda minus minus version. Yeah, it's showing conda correctly, but it's not showing Python. I think we made some error in that. So again, we can close it. Let's go to again Anaconda prompt and let's see the path. And where? Python, perfectly fine. What's the problem in that? Anaconda 3, control C. I'm closing it again, and again, searching environment variables. Environment variables, path, edit. It's there already. What's the problem? Edit. Paste it. I think it should run properly. Everything is perfect. Okay. Again, click. Okay. Again, click. Okay. Again, try to run that. If it doesn't happen, let me check it manually then. Let me just type Python instead of that. Let's see what shows. No, it's not recognizing again. Python minus minus version. Why it is not showing that? Even it is showing the conda version, minus minus version. Conda is, it is perfectly showing the path. Why it is not showing the path? Just a second again, I'm closing it.
Sir, Python, there are two paths are given. So it may be possible second path may be used for
the... Let me check. Let me just give me a second. Users tell. Users tell, and it should be here somewhere. Anaconda 3. Same path is there. I don't know why it is not recognizing. Path is absolutely fine. Users tell Anaconda 3. Here we have a python.exe. It should work. Go again and check. It should not happen. Otherwise, I have to do again. Don't worry. I got the prompt. Where Python uses tell app data local low. It's fine. Perfectly fine. I don't know what's the problem in that.
Sir, why there is two path I've shown over here?
Actually, that is the data, app data. That is the app data.
Right.
Sir, I think you should copy that slash Python EXT also.
No need of that. No need of that. We didn't copy it in the case of Aconda as well. If you see that, if I'm typing here, Viaconda. See, I just copied till scripts. I didn't copy this slash one. Okay, I didn't copy this slash. We can check it out. Let me open environment variables. I did system environment variable. Benmax find variables, path, edit. See, it is fine. I don't know what's the problem. Let me delete it. New. Paste again. I think it should work because we are not doing any error whatsoever. This is the procedures we do. Okay. Fingers crossed. Let's check it again. There's no error we are doing. I don't know what's happening. Python. Just a second. Let me close this. Let me give a try. Let me close it. Let me quit it. Python from here. It's fine. Perfectly fine. Now I'm again closing it. I'm opening command prompt. I'm typing Python --- person. What happened? I don't know what's the problem behind that. We are doing absolutely perfect. This is the normal procedure we do because otherwise it would have been some mistake. We could have even seen the Conda version. The same procedure we followed for the Conda version as well. We are doing some mistake. It's showing perfectly. I don't know the same path we are following here. Why it is doing some error? Okay, let me give one more try here. Environment variables. Although that is not recommended method. No, this is not a thing. Add it. Let me C:// /user/tel. Delete it.
No, sir.
Yeah, beta, please tell
Hello,
me.
Sir.
Yeah, beta, please tell me.
Sir, whatever procedure you have told, I have just tried in my machine, but it is working.
You're working?
Yes, sir, it is working. Means whatever you have just told, na?
Uh-huh.
So, at first I go to Anaconda prompt, okay?
Yeah.
There I type where Python. Then basically it will show the means corresponding, like in my case, it is user/user/Python. Something address is given, okay? And I copy this thing and I set the environment. And there I placed it, whatever procedure you have just told. And after that, I open my command prompt. And there I just typed Python version. Then it is shows Python 3.9.6.
It's working perfectly in your case, right?
Yes.
Same
yes,
procedure,
sir.
Right? Exactly same procedure, right?
Yes, sir.
Why it is not working in my case? Yeah, please, can you check everyone? If you are working on a system, can you check, please? Can you people check, please? If you are working on a system, if you people can check and confirm, is it working on your same method in your system or not, please? So that I can be sure that it's problem of my system only. Please check if somebody has opened the system, somebody's working on the system. Is anybody else is giving a try?
Yes, sir.
Please tell me. What is the problem? I'll check again. This is actually, please.
Sir, when you are putting that address, na, like user, in case of it is user C, user, Anaconda 3. And what you have written there, user something like that, then Anaconda 3, you have to put the slash also.
Okay, let me check. Normally it's not required, but let me check. Let me see that, because we didn't that in the Anaconda also, remember?
Yes, sir.
We didn't that in the Anaconda also. Don't worry, we track that also. It may be a new modification or something. Let me check. Path, edit. Let me try that also. /. I think it should work now. That is the case. Python minus minus was it? No, it's not showing again. I think there's some problem in my system. Please, anybody, please check and confirm me so that I can come to know. It is working in one person's system. It should work in everybody else's system. Because our procedure is more than 100% accurate. Because otherwise, it could have worked in the Anaconda, in the Conda case.
Yes, sir, it's fine.
It's working?
Not working in my system, sir.
Not working?
Yes, sir, it's working.
It's working.
It is working.
It's working. Same procedure that
yes,
you followed?
Sir. Okay. Yes, sir. Same procedure.
Okay. Then what's the problem? I don't know here. What's happening in my system? I've worked same way 1,000 times. Remember?
Okay, sir. Let's check. Let's last.
I don't know what happened here. Anybody else can confirm, please?
It's not working in my system, sir.
Even Conda. Conda is check the Conda version. Check the version of Conda. Type Conda minus minus version. Check it. It's working perfect. Python, it is not accepting. There may be one option, Python minus minus version. Again, let me check task manager. Just a second. Let me close it somewhere if Python is running in the backhood. Anybody else can confirm, please? For three people, it is working, including me and a girl. I don't know her name. What's the name, Bida?
Amulya, sir.
Amulya, it's not working in your case. Conda one is working or not?
No, sir.
Conda should work. Conda is working perfectly. You saw that it's working. 4.10.1. It's showing that exactly. Please check it. I don't know what's the problem behind this, why it is not accepting that. It should accept.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir, will you please take it after class? Shall we move next one?
Sure. Okay, fine. Sure. That's fine. Let's move ahead. I think it will be done. There may be some bug here. Let me check it. But this is the normal procedure. Because if in some cases it is working, then there may be some issue in our systems. Because otherwise, it could have been bug in the other people also. Okay, let's move ahead. So, but I got an idea what is PYC files, right? Everybody got an idea. PYC file is known as Python compiled files. I hope it is clear to everyone. Okay, so we studied the basic features of the Python. What is Python? Okay, and what are the different features of it? It's a high level language. It's derived the features from C. And Java, C is a procedure-based language, and Java is an object-oriented language. And then we identified what is mean by class, what do you mean by an object. Then we move to the dynamically typed language, what is statically typed language, what is dynamically typed language. Then we discuss Python is an interpreted language, right? Means we need to convert a high-level language into the machine-level language. Then we study the difference between a compiler and an interpreter. How a compiler works and how an interpreter works, then we understand how the Python code actually get executed. Okay, first of all, a Python compiler is being used, which converts your high level language into an intermediate language, which is known as bytecode. And that bytecode is converted to the low level language using a Python virtual machine, which consists of an interpreter. I hope till this point, everything is clear. Is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I'm moving ahead. I'm using no Python 5. I'm opening the Jupyter notebook. The first thing that you should understand in Python is to write the comments. How will you write the comments? Okay, so there are two kind of comments you can write. One is a single line comment, and second one is a multi-line comment. I repeat once again, single line comment and is a multi-line comment. What is the benefit of the comments is, if somebody is reading the code, the comments help you out to understand what is being written over there. That is the best part of the comments. Okay, it makes easier for the reader of the code what you have done actually, And it, at the same time, it tells about the interpreter that you cannot convert this piece of instruction which is written here into your machine level language. Means you need not convert the thing which is written inside the command to your machine level language. That's fine. Is it fine? So now see what happens. How can you create a single line command? To create a single line command, you have to press hash. You have to press hash. Okay. So hash, the moment you press hash, hash means after this, everything else is going to be ignored by interpreter. It will understand it is a simple what? It is a command. So I can write whatever I want to write. I can write a simple language. Hi, this is our first Python journey. Is it fine? Right? If I execute it, that's fine. Nothing is going to be happening. If I didn't put this hash here and write this and run this code, it will throw me an error. Can you see that? Right? So if you want to write something as a command, always start with a hash. Okay. If you want to write multi-line commands, you can again type hash and do that. Again, you can do that. Anything means this is our third class. Okay. Again, you can multiple way. This is one way to write multi-line commands, push hash everywhere. But suppose you don't want to push hash again and again and again. So there is one way to do that. How? Use triple quotes. I repeat, triple quotes means either double quotes three times. One, two, and how many times it has become? I think it has become three, right? Three times double quotes or three times single quotes. Same way, you can write here, like, hi, hope you are enjoying the journey. But still, lot more to go. We all have to work hard. Okay, this is the way. Now, I run the code. Fine. No error is there. Is it fine? Because we put everything inside the triple quotes. No error is there. Okay. So sometimes you want to write the multi-line commands, which is not a recommended method, honestly speaking. But sometimes if you want to write the multi-line commands, you can use triple double quotes, or you can use, instead of that, single quotes three times. One, two, three. And again, you can copy it from this three quotes, open, control X, and paste it here. Again, you can do that. Both are equivalent. Is it fine how to write the comments? Please tell me.
Yes, sir.
Is it okay? So single line comments, you will write with the help of hash. And if you want to go to the multi-line command, use three times, either single quotes or the back quotes. Starting quotes will be three and the ending quotes will be three. This is one thing. Second very important thing for the Python is, if you people are aware, that is a variables. Very, very important thing to understand what is a variable. Okay. So variables are what and how these are different from your C language. How these are different from your C language means how variables are treated in the Python and how variables are different from the variables in the programming language like C. Understand properly. Why variables are used? Basically, variables are used to store data in the memory. As simple as that. Remember, understand. Variables are used to store data in the memory. And what happens? Understand. Suppose I write a variable. The name is salary. Which is a variable, and I type 1000. And how it will be executed? I take up a variable known as salary, and I put up a value equal to 1000. Then what will happen? How this will work? Understand that thing. how it is different from your other languages. Okay. What instruction we have written? We have written the instruction to be like salary equals 2000. Okay. So what will happen? The moment you execute it, what will happen? A memory space will be assigned to you. A memory space somewhere on your memory. This is your memory. Some space will be assigned to you. And in that space, this data will be stored. That is 1000. Okay. The moment we execute salary is equal to 1000, a memory space will be assigned to me. And in that memory space, 1000 will be stored. And after storing that data, a label will be assigned to this, or a tag will be assigned to it, a label or tag, which will be known as salary. So next time you want to access this 1000, you can use the name salary over there. It's just a tag. The moment, for example, you are creating a file in your office and you want to make it presentable, but there are lots and lots of documents which are attached. Your boss wants to identify. Please, this is very difficult to identify each and every document. Better you put some label there or text there. You take green color text or orange color text, put some name there. For example, resume 2019-20. Put at the top of the 1920 file. The moment 1920 file end means documents end, your 1890 begins, put a tag over there at the bottom, at the top, so that your boss can understand, okay, now from this point onwards, 1819 are starting. Those are tags you are putting or labels you are putting. Same way here, the tag has been put, which is known as salary. Is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Understand how it works? I'm repeating once again. The moment you put salary is equal to 1000, a memory space will be assigned to you. Okay. And in that memory space, 1000 will be stored. And a tag will be placed or a label will be placed over there. A tag or a label will be placed over there. And that tag or label will be known as salary. And so whenever you want to access that 1000 again, you can use the term known as salary. Example, I'm going to the code section. I'm running this code. I just run this. Now, suppose I want to see what data salary is pointing to. So I can just in the print is an inbuilt function in the Python. It's an inbuilt function. In the best way to identify functions in the Python, you will have these kind of brackets after that. And if you want to know what this print function does, going inside, press Shift and Tab. Going inside, press Shift plus Tab. So it will open a talk string, means statement, what it does actually. Okay. Another way to know about this print function is another function in the Python, which is known as help, which tells you about every function inside the Python. Again, it's a function. So you will see these brackets. And what you want to know? You want to know about the print. So inside the help, type print. And run this, you will see help on the built-in function print in the module definition, prints the value to the stream. Can you see that? Okay, so now what I want to do, I want to see what salary is pointing to. Salary variable is pointing to what content. So what I will do, I will use print. So anything you want to print on the screen, use a print statement or print function. And within that function, you want to print what salary is pointing to. Salary is pointing to 1000. So you should set 1000 only. So salary, exact name you type here. Salary. The moment you type salary here, run it. You will see salary is pointing to a memory location, which is storing 1000. Now, suppose I want to revise salary of some person. Okay. Whatever his older salary is, I want to add 200 rupees to that. Instead of rousing earlier salary was 1000 rupees. So instead of using that 1000 again, what I can use? Again, use the term salary. But salary is pointing to 1000 only. So I can type new salary equals to older salary is what? SALARY plus how much you want to add? You want to add 200. Run this code. It's run. Print this. I want to see what is the new salary now. New underscore salary. And run this code. I should get 1200. So wherever this 1000 is, you can use salary over here. I hope it is clear to everyone, please. How Python treats with the variables. Variables are nothing but tags to the memory location where data is stored, or labels to a memory location where data is stored. Is it fine? Please tell me.
Yes, sir.
Everyone, please.
Yes, sir.
Now move further. If I want to know what is the memory location where this 1000 is stored, I can just use a function again known as ID. In that, type your variable name. What is your variable name? Salary. It will tell me the memory location where it is stored. See, this is the memory location where the salary is stored. Now, how it is different from C? Now come to that. That is very, very important. In C, suppose I want to create same variable and assign it the value of salary. Okay, so I will use the term, for example, it is an integer. I will type int salary, example, and then salary equals to 1000. We'll see what will happen. First of all, a memory location will be assigned to you again. Again, a memory location will be assigned to you. Or a container will be assigned to you. And that container will be known as salary now. That container will be known as salary. And inside this container, or this container will be known as salary. And what this container will be storing? It will be storing 1000. Okay, so the moment you write this expression, a memory location is named as salary. And with that memory location, 1000 is stored. You must be confusing, sir. Seems same thing. Here we are putting salary, here also putting salary. Here it is a tag, it's not a name. Here it's a name. You will understand that. Suppose I have a variable in Python, I write a equals to 10. Okay, and then I write another variable b equals to a in Python. Okay, and same thing I do in C. I type int a, let's say, equals to 10. Int a equals to 10. Initialize I did. Then I type int b equals to a. What will happen when I execute this statement? When I execute this statement, then the moment I press int a memory location will be assigned to me, which will be named as A. And within A, 10 will be. Fine. The moment I execute this instruction int B, again, the moment this instruction is executed, a new memory location assigned to me, known as B. And what is put? Whatever the value A is having, that is 10. So same content 10 they are having, but at the different memory locations. But in Python, what happens? Remember how the Python treats variable. You press a equals to 10. So first of all, a memory location is assigned to you, a memory space is assigned to you in which 10 is stored. Okay, and then you put a tag known as a. You put a tag known as A. So A will point to 10. Now, when you write B equals to A, you're not pointing to new data. You're pointing to tag. So B will also become a tag to 10. Means they both will point to same memory location. Here, they will point to different memory location. I hope it is clear.
Yes, sir.
Is it fine? In C programming, they will point to different memory location, but in Python, they will point to same memory location. Let me show you that. Here, I'm typing A equals to 10. Fine. And here I'm typing B equals to A. Okay. I execute this instruction. And beside that, I type print. What ID of A? Can you tell me the memory location where A is pointing? Print ID of B, point where B is pointing to. Can you tell me what I will get? Will I get the same numbers or different? It's Python.
Same, sir.
Yes. Please check it. Can you verify the numbers?
So what is the full form of ID?
It is just identification. We know that identification. There's nothing specific full name is given to here. We call it ID. ID basically tells us about the location, identification, where our memory location is.
Okay.
I never ever actually even tried to know what is ID. I just know what ID does, honestly speaking. I understand always what ID does. ID tells me the memory location where it is pointing to. Is it fine, Bita?
Yes, sir.
Any doubt, Bita, anyone? In today's class, please.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, Bita, please tell me.
So this ID is not basically the address of that particular memory location.
It is pointing to that way. It is telling me the ID of A means it is telling me the memory location, address of the memory location where A is pointing to.
So, ma'am, sir, so the ID is different and address is different.
Yeah. No, it is ID is telling you basically what this ID is doing is ID is telling you where A is pointing to. Actually, what happens every time you will run this code, for example, this is right now you are running, right? Where we are. Discussing in terms of your RAM, your main memory about. It tells us about the main memory we are about. That's why we are running it next time. If I open a new window or do the same task, if I do the same task again, then what it will do? Then it will again tell you the different thing. Okay? It basically tells you identity of an object. In, if you want to talk about technical terms, we can call it as identity of an object. In shorter word.
So yeah, this number is basically the ID and the this ID is
identity, pointing to, yes, object, pointing to object which is known as
pointing to object A.
Yeah. Pointing to object
and it 10. Has an address.
Yeah. Pointing yes, okay. to an object 10 and it's 10. Its ID.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. It's your object is 10 and it is pointing to that object. Same object they are pointing. So identity of both are same.
Okay, sir.
Is it fine?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Anybody else? But any doubt? You can easily say it's identity of an object. That's the easier way to remember. I told you in the beginning itself, Python consists of everything as an object. Right? So where this object is stored, it is telling me the ID of that. And from the same concept we just studied, they're both pointing to the same thing. So IDs of the same object is A and B should be the same value. I hope it is clear to everyone.
Yes, sir.
Anyone, yes, sir. Anyone, any doubt? Please tell me any doubt whatsoever in today's class. Except that one, I don't know what it happened, how it is not working. I will restart my computer and check that again. For sure, why it is not working, but this is the normal procedure because it's working in the other people. Exactly same procedure they are following and they're getting the output. I don't know how come we are not getting the output.
Hello, sir.
Yeah, please tell me.
Sir, the bytecode which we got after in that command prompt. Mm-hmm. So how will we share that particular?
That is a PYC. You will see that PYC files. You will share PYC files.
So the PYC, when I'm clicking on that PYC file, it gets executed and it comes out of that file.
Just a second. Let me open that. Don't worry. When you have a PYC Python compiler installed in your system, it can be directly called. PYC file can directly be used also. You can directly use PYC files. If you want, I can show you that execution also. Don't worry about that. This is the PY cache file. You can use it. Okay, you can use it. It's asking for the app. By default, it's not available. So if you do have a PVM specially installed, you can directly import that PYC files and directly use that. Don't worry about it. You can use it. That's not a problem at all. Anyone else? But any doubt, please.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah, please tell me.
Sir, we have converted this high-level language into low-level language. No, sir, we use the same processor to convert low-level language to high-level, sir?
No. Low-level language to high-level language, we rarely do. Why we want to convert that? See, actually what happens, who trains the machine? Humans train the machine, right? Whatever code the machine understands, who wrote that code? We are doing something. Machines can't do anything until we do something there. For example, if you are from EC branch or electronics and communication branch, there is a different processors, 8085 processors, right? 8086 processors, core i3 processors, core i5 processors. Everything has a different hardware specification. Everything has a different specification. I never saw that we used to convert low level language into high level language. But you can do that. How you can do that? That's easy task. It's in terms of ones and zeros. Understand the piece concept like this. Which branch you are from, ma'am? Can you tell me? Yeah, ma'am?
Electronics, sir.
Yeah, okay. In which year you are?
Third year, sir.
Okay, so you must have studied microprocessor?
Yes, sir.
Okay, and microprocessor, there is a thing known as assembly language?
Yes, sir.
Right, and assembly language is what? It's normally written in the hex code format. If you can see that, when you dump that assembly language into machine, you dump them in the format of hex code. For example, FA2. Right, or 6AB. How these machine languages are coded, understand that concept. Suppose in my program, let me tell you, I want an instruction like move A comma B. Understand this one, right? Move A comma B. So move is what? Move is an instruction, okay? And how do we code them? Suppose my system has 1,000 instructions. Okay. So each instruction should be uniquely identified. So to represent 1,000 instructions, how many binary digits you require? You require 2^10, that is 10 binary digits. Okay. So first instruction, suppose, is an instruction known as add. So you will write in the 10 digit as 00000567810. Next instruction is subtract. You will write 00000001. Next instruction is suppose divide. You will write 00000010 and so on. This is binary code of every instruction. Okay. So what you did, you take move and do this. And suppose how many registers you are having, accordingly code them. Suppose those are 4 or 5. So you just 2 digits for them, suppose 0001 or something like that. Okay. So how you will convert that into the hex code? You will convert that into the hex code. How? Group 4 digits at a time. This way. 4 digits, which will be known as 0. These 4 digits again as 0. This 4 digits again as 0. So what we get? 000H for one instruction. Suppose that instruction is add AB. Example, add AB. Right? We got to the assembly, which we can understand as the English language. Is it fine, ma'am, or not?
Yes, sir.
You got an idea?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Actually, to view the output, low level, high level language, to view the output.
ma'am, actually what we do whenever we are writing the code, na, so we always write most of the time code in the high level language. Okay, and we use the help of translators because to understand that low level language is not easy for you. For example, you are from digital background, so you are able to understand what I am doing here. Okay, if somebody is from civil background, he will not be able to understand that. But what happens if you go to Tata Consultancy Services or Cognizant or Accenture? Everyone, everywhere, there is a software engineers, right? And those software engineers are working on the programming languages. And those software programming engineers may be from civil background, they may be from mechanical background, they may be from biomedical background, but they are working on the software programs. So they can't understand this thing. It's very difficult to understand. So better what? Use English-like language, which is your high-level language. So they normally work on the high-level language because they know there are softwares which will convert my high-level language into the low-level language. Why I need to focus on the low-level language?
Yes, sir, I understood, sir.
Okay. Anything else? Anybody? And I hope you enjoyed the session and liked the session and the learning as well.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah, please tell me.
Sir, after resolving the command prompt problem, please let me know it, sir.
Sure. It will be resolved for sure. Guaranteed it will be resolved. Let me check why it is not working. Trust me, I've done this 1,000 times.
Yes, sir, I got the Conda
thing. Conda thing, you got. Yeah, Python you are not getting, right?
Yes, sir.
Let me check that. Why it is not happening? Because if there would have been any fault in our process, na, we could have got the Conda as well.
Yes, sir.
So fault is not in the process because some people are getting it. I think there is some version of Windows or something, compatibility issue is coming, so far as I understand, because I have updated my Windows nearly 1 month back, and maybe that you may also have a latest Windows, if I'm correct.
Sir.
Right. So that may be in one of the issues. Don't worry, we'll resolve it for sure. Don't worry. Okay, and but from what happened from the next week, we are having classes from Monday to Friday. Okay, Monday to Friday means 5 days a week. We will have a class of minimum 1.15, means one and a half hour or 1.15 times. Okay, so 3 days you have a break, means tomorrow you have a break. Basically, Saturday, Sunday will be off all the time. Tomorrow you have a break. We'll meet on Monday again. So meanwhile, you can practice everything that we have studied, and from Monday we'll move ahead. Is it fine to everyone? Actually, it was the first week, so intentionally we kept it for the 3 days because things becomes quite complex. If we keep on moving, we want to keep it lighter on the first week so that next week you can put the paddle on. Because if you feed the child is born everything on the first day, he will either vomit or he will do the loose motion. So we have to keep that into the consideration, right? And don't worry about the days. Doesn't matter. I have promised 6 weeks. Even sometimes if your syllabus is not completed, means the portion is not completing, I will take classes on Saturday and Sunday. Don't worry about that. It's my promise to you. I will not leave you in between ever. That's my promise. Is it fine with everyone?
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Any doubt with anyone, better please tell me. So 3 days break you have. Meanwhile, install all the things and keep everything in your brain. Don't mug up. Keep everything in your brain, what it works, how it works and everything. And I've tried to make it as simple as possible. And I don't know how successful I was, but I'm trying my level best so that I can reach to a level of you, so that you people can understand each and every concept. Is it fine?
Yes, sir.
Everyone,
yes,
please.
Sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So, okay, beta. See you on the Monday, same time, 6 p.m. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Thanks, everyone, and God bless you.
Thank you, sir.
Good night, sir.
Good night. Good night. Thank you.